I forgot to record earlier. Oh no. Hi everyone. Thank you, April, for your presentation. And as you guys can see, we have a really extensive team serving and supporting the Dream.us scholars. Our community is super big. We're a group of over 200 roughly. And so there's many more of you guys on campus than you think. And so really excited. So right under Classroom to Career Hub, the Student Support and Retention Department falls under. And so that's where I serve alongside, closely work with Lauren, who introduced herself earlier. And so what we do is mainly support students, scholars who receive any of the scholarships, DSF, Mapleton, Pathways to Possible is another one recently. And many other smaller ones too. And so what we do is just like degree planning. We coach you all the way through from start to finish, provide any support services such as like internships, scholarship opportunities, anything similar to immigrant services. We just support, if you're missing any financial aid documents, we let you know. And we're really here to support you. And if you have any questions or understanding any forms, we're here to help with that. And given that, we also have a group on Microsoft Teams. And so if you guys haven't noticed already or received notifications or emails, we roughly post there for any events, scholarship opportunities, deadlines, renewals, and anything like that. And so definitely keep eyes on that bulletin, group Teams. And so there's also been a few scholars that have already introduced themselves via there. So if you want to share an introduction or share anything about you, feel free to use that platform. And then next, we'll move on to Pathway and Career Link. Just like April mentioned, you can find internships, jobs, you can upload your resume to Career Link, and you'll also find your pathway. And so being part of the Dream.us Scholar, being part of Student Support and Retention Department, you also get to participate in pathway requirements. And so these are simple requirements that should not be additional work for you that you guys are already doing. And they will be, these requirements consist of two individual meetings, one with myself and one with Immigrant Services. With me, you'll be mainly working on degree planning, or if you're missing anything, or just like a catch up. Essentially, another requirement will be to attend a campus event or resource, and this can be tutoring center, writing center. You can meet with Pablo if you're struggling on a paper, anything career counseling. It can be a wide variety of resources. We will let you know as we meet with you one-on-one, what can that be and where does that look like. In addition to we'll give you a monthly newsletter and you can find those opportunities there. And you can always reach out to us. What does that look like? The other requirement will be career engagement. So you can be attending any fairs. You can upload your resume to Vault, like April mentioned. You can do mock interviews, anything that has to do career related. In that pathway, you'll also see volunteer, and that's an optional requirement. And that's mainly for other scholars. And so if you're part of another scholarship, that might fall under you. But these are requirements are super simple, nothing additional work, but that would be something we can work on along the way. Pathway is super simple to find. It's in Career Link right under Jobs and Careers in your Student Hub. You'll get more information from me and the team sent out via email and in the Microsoft group Teams. And then that's all I have on my end, and I'll jump it over to Kelly. And here's my contact info. I'll drop it in the chat.
Hi, everyone. My name is Kelly Finley, and I am your financial aid contact for the Dream.us. And also, if you guys, I know there's a lot of overlap with DSF, so I would also be a contact for DSF or Gear Up. And I'm trying to think if there's anything else. If you have any scholarships, basically just reach out to me if you have questions on them. But as far as how the Dream.us works here at MSU Denver, The way it works is that we will report to them what your tuition and fees are, and then DreamUS then sends your money to the school. We then put that money onto your financial aid account, and it's always going to pay towards your tuition and fees first. And then if you have excess funding, that leftover funding would come to you guys as a refund. If you only have the DreamUS, you might have some excess funding, but possibly not, depending on how much your tuition and fees are and what type of scholar you are. If you have like the DreamUS and DSF or institutional funding, then you'll probably have some leftover funds, and that would come back as a refund to you. In order to remain eligible to receive DreamUS funding and the institutional matching funds, you do need to renew your CASFA application and your DreamUS scholarship application every year. So if you haven't done a CASFA application yet, make sure that you complete that so that we can give you matching funds of $500 from the school per semester. Next. Okay, so the amount of money you receive is going to vary based upon what type of scholar you are. So you're either going to be considered a first-time college student or a community college graduate. I assume that all of you know which one you fall under. So based upon that, your awards are going to be different. So I can't give not everyone's going to have the same amount of awards. So if your friend has one amount and you have a different amount, that doesn't mean anything is wrong. And then we consider your base tuition and fees. So DreamUS only pays base tuition and fees. They won't cover health insurance. So if you have the school's health insurance, that you are responsible for. And then they don't cover extra fees, such as lab charges. Some classes have just random extra fees that are like $30 or something like that. So it's not going to be covered. Most of the time that you're pretty much fully covered anyway between the tuition fees we report and the extra $500 they send in. But if you have questions up on your award once it pays in, then feel free to reach out to me. They do reduce your award based upon if you're receiving state aid. The only state aid they're looking at is the Colorado Student Grant. So you'll see it on your account as CSG. You might have other aid as well, like another scholarship, but we won't reduce the DreamUS funds for those unless you go over your cost of attendance. That's pretty rare that we would have to reduce anything. But if we do, it's because you have so much aid that I don't have room in your budget, and we'll just save your DreamUS funds for the following semester. Next. Okay, so these are the maximum awards by semester. So take a look at this and decide which, they both say high school graduate. The one on the right is the community college graduate, and the one on the left is the high school graduate amount. But basically, these are the maximum awards per semester. So if you're coming in as a high school student, the maximum that you can receive per semester from the DreamUS and the MSU matching funds is $46.25. And then the maximum on the right is for a community college graduate is $82.50. Now, if you're a community college graduate, you're likely not going to be receiving that much because your tuition and fees shouldn't be $7,250. That only would probably apply to nursing program. They have a much higher tuition fees amount. So don't be expecting that you're receiving $82.50 per semester. That's just the most you can receive. The book stipend is very confusing the way they describe it, because the book stipend is included with the money they send us for your tuition fees. So we just receive one payment. So everything goes towards your tuition fees first. So you may not necessarily have $500 for books left over. You have to look at what your tuition fees charges are and what your other aid is as well. There's nothing that you need to submit to that. So you don't need to submit to me or to the DreamUS like a receipt for books you've purchased or anything. It just comes automatically with your tuition payment. So again, you'll want to look at what your bill is and then determine how much you're going to have left over for tuition and fees. Again, this is the maximum you can receive, not the amount you will receive. And if you have a CSG on your account, you need to reduce your award by that amount. Next. Okay, so here's just some examples of what, you know, your award could look like as a refund. So in this example for the high school graduate, they show the tuition and fees charges that I would report to the Dream US, and then the payment you receive from them, the matching funds from us, and then the book stipend. So you'll see that the total refund for this student is actually $549, so more than the $500 book stipend. The community college graduate student has a larger Dream US payment, and so they're receiving a $1,000 refund. This is per semester and just an example, but that's kind of how the payments break down. So when you look at your student account, you're not gonna see two Dream US payments posting in, it's just one large payment. Really important, if you didn't fill out your CASFA form, then you will not have any matching funds from the school. It's a pretty quick form and it pretty much guarantees your $500 matching funds, and so make sure that you complete that if you have it. Next. All right, so when will you see your award? So you should see your estimated award placed onto your financial aid account, financial aid screen, a couple weeks before the start of the semester, which I realize now is a couple weeks before the start of the semester. So it'll probably be on your account within the next 2 weeks, just on the financial aid screen. You won't see that on your tuition and fees screen until it pays in. And funds for the Dream US don't pay in until about 45 days after school starts. So you won't get any late fees or interest charges because we'll protect your account from that. But you are still going to get notification from the cashier's office that you have unpaid tuition. And that's just an automatic thing that'll come to you until your Dream US funding comes in. The estimated award that we will put on there is based upon what your enrolled hours are when we pull that report. So if you start changing your schedule or dropping or adding classes, it could change the amount of the award that's coming in. Since your money doesn't come in until, you know, kind of far into the semester, if you do need to buy books before your payment arrives, you are eligible to charge up to $750 per term at the Tivoli. And that's going to be charged to your tuition and fees. Sorry, my lights in my office just came out. But you're responsible for making sure you have enough of those funding. So if you charge $750 for books at the Tivoli, but you're only getting, you know, a $300 refund from us, you're ultimately going to be responsible for paying that difference. So make sure you're not buying more than you need and buying more than you have coming in. Next. Okay, so like I said, you won't get late fees and you won't be dropped from classes. We'll make sure to protect your account from that while we're waiting for your money to come in. If you don't see any $500 matching funds from the school after everything's paid in, you need to make sure that you've completed your CASFA and that you're not on any SAP or anything like that with our office. If you don't see a scholarship awarded onto your account, either an estimated award in financial aid or later into the semester if you don't see a payment, the main reason is that, you know, you could have lost your scholarship due to the renewal deadline. So obviously if it's your first semester, you wouldn't have had to renew by now, but make sure that once we get further into schooling for you that you're renewing every year. The other thing is if we don't have you listed at all as a Dream US scholar, that shouldn't be the case if you're invited here. So probably not going to be an issue. But if you don't see your scholarship and you think you should have one, definitely make sure to reach out to me. We could have missed your enrollment or had the wrong student ID or something strange for you. So contact us as soon as possible after, before a week before school, if you want, if you don't see an estimated award on your financial aid screen, contact us and let us know. We can see if there's anything wrong or it just hasn't been put on there yet. Next. This part isn't for me, but I don't know, Jasmine, are we like doing questions now or later?
Yep. I'll go ahead and take this slide over. In order to stay eligible with the Dream.us scholarship, like Kelly said, renew. So next year in June, beginning of June, you'll get an email from the Dream.us ISTS with instructions on how to renew. You'll have to upload transcripts, report your status, basic information, and your GPA as well too. Like being said, your cumulative GPA has to stay above a 2.5. And if you do fall under the 2.5, you can work with myself, Gregor, Stephanie, or Pablo in order to boost your GPA and also have approval for renewal at the time. Enrollment, you have to enroll for 12 credits. If you plan on going part-time or taking a break in enrollment, please let us know. You still qualify and you're still eligible to receive the scholarship if you go part-time. And so just let us know what's going on, what's your situation. So if the first semester didn't go so well and you want to take a break, you can do so, or you can go part-time. So just let us know. Again, so break in enrollment, you can take a semester off. So what Dream.us does is they request, you guys are required to request a break in enrollment. So we'll provide the contact information in order to, for you guys to request those break in enrollments. You can request three, not semester to semester. So if you take two semesters off, you can do that. If you take three at the same time, you cannot do that. You can take one at a time. So it's really up to you what your situation is. And so, because they, and so specifically with online school too, so if that's not something you want to do, you can take a break or go part-time. And that's pretty much it for staying eligible. Any questions about eligibility? The scholarship itself, it's super flexible. If anything comes up throughout the semester, just reach out to us and we can work with you to remain eligible. Any questions on how the scholarship works with financial aid here on campus, here at MSU? So Stephanie, I'll turn it over to you for the student panel. I know we're few minutes early, so maybe this is a good time, Pablo, for the poll.
Yeah, let me go ahead and put it out. So after hearing all of this information, I guess the poll has been answered. Okay, never mind. So it looks like, let me share some of the results. It seems as though a lot of people are feeling very excited. And some people are feeling okay. Some people are nervous and worried, and that's okay. And a lot of people are feeling all of these emotions, but I hope this information is helping you feel better. I'm gonna introduce Fanny, who is gonna introduce the panel who's gonna be talking to you today. So without further ado, here is Fanny again.
Hey everyone, well, I'm seeing at the panel and I'm noticing that a lot of you are feeling all of the above. And, you know, it's completely normal to be feeling excited. I mean, it's a scholarship. I remember when I first got my scholarship and I received the email, I was completely excited because at a point I had lost like hope of going to college because I didn't know how I was going to afford it. But also I was very worried and nervous, like, oh no, like, what if I'm missing something? And so that is why we're here to help. For the student panel, we will, you know, students will be coming in a little bit late. So at 3:05, I do see one of our panelists here. So I'm very excited. But for now, but while it's three, I just wanna ask if one of you wants to unmute and share how you're feeling. I know we saw the poll, but if you want to add a little bit to that. And then at three, let's have a small bio break. So to grab some food, grab some tea, coffee, snacks, whatever it is. But yeah, let's do a quick going around how we're feeling and if you want to add a little bit to it.
I think I'm going to go first. I'm feeling very excited because, like I mentioned before, I am a Dream US recipient. And I mentioned this in all the orientations, but the Dream US recipients are my favorite recipients. No offense to other scholarship recipients, but y'all are my favorite. I know I shouldn't have any. But I'm just excited to get to know y'all. And like, I know I met some of y'all and I've already worked with some of you, and I can't wait to like get a chance to meet y'all in person and get a chance to just like work together, you know. I'm really excited.
Anyone else want to share? Not all at once, please.
Hi, my name's Carmen, and I just wanted to say that I'm feeling excited, yet very much nervous and anxious, because it's obviously a really good opportunity, but I also get anxious about everything.
Thank you, Carmen, for sharing and being the first to like share. Also really good to see you again or hear you. But yeah, completely normal to be excited and nervous, all of these emotions at the same time. Okay, who's next?
Hi, my name is Yareli. I'm actually really excited to be joining the team and getting to know everybody. It makes me feel really comfortable that everybody's basically kind of like from the same, not from the same, but we all like understand the kind of path that we're all similarly walking on, so that makes me feel a lot more comfortable. So yeah, thank you guys.
Oh, thank you, Yareli. We're also very excited to have all of you being part of our team. I agree, Luis. Okay, I'm recognizing a lot of names. I'll choose. I don't wanna do that. I really want you to tell me how you're feeling.
I'll go next. So my name is Christian. At first I was really nervous because obviously the scholarship's an exciting opportunity, but I was more nervous about how to navigate and how to understand everything. But I find all this very helpful and very constructive. So I feel a lot better now. And similar to what Yareli said, feel very comfortable knowing that we all come from the same walk in life, sort of. So just knowing that we have a giant support group, that's really good feeling to me and makes me feel really comfortable and at home.
Yes, I'm happy to hear that. And you're right, our community here at MSU Denver of the Dream That US Scholars is big. And so our hope is that we can create that strong community within each other as a former scholar. It's what was very helpful. And I really appreciated Jasmine and the team, Gregor, being able to support us and creating also like events to help us become engaged. Okay, well, if no one else wants to share, and please feel free to jump in. We can take a 5-minute break really quickly, but let's come back like around 3:05, 3:06, and hopefully our panelists will be here. But also I'll be here, so feel free to continue sharing. I love to hear from all of you and just get to put a face to the names that I've been emailing with or talking on the phone. Comment a question that says, what happens if we cannot make it to the in-person orientation tomorrow? Jasmine, would you like to respond?
Nothing happens. It's up to you if you want to join us tomorrow. We'll be streamlining the National Dream.us scholarship orientation, and we'll have pizza. We'll have other support programs presenting. So Pathways to Possible will be there, Peer Mentoring will be there, RISE will be there. So if you're interested in joining any of those programs, feel free to join us tomorrow. And you get to mingle with other Dream.us scholars as well too. So you can definitely join us. Where will the live stream be? It will be in the Aerospace Building in the Forum. So it's right next to Jordan Success Building. I'll drop the chat in the chat box, our map. It's in the Aerospace Building. So if you were here for the Social Summer Thrill, it's in the same building. We'll have signs.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Bunny.
Oh no, I was gonna say that it's also a nice place. I really like the Aerospace Building. So I don't know, it's just very nice, modern, and architecturally really beautiful, I think. I don't know if that's the right word, but sounds right.
Mm-hmm. It's our newest building, so it's really fun.
Yes. Okay, so a couple more minutes and we'll get started here soon. There's another question, same time as today.
It's from 12 to 2. 12 to 2, guys.
And there's going to be pizza, so definitely come eat with us. Also, I want to mention that if you haven't been to campus yet, it's a good opportunity to come and look at the campus, how beautiful it is. It's actually a really big campus. Yes, I knew it, Yeremy. I knew that I would say pizza and we would have you all coming. Who doesn't like pizza? I'm lactose intolerant, but I don't mind it. I'll eat me a piece of pizza.
Yeah. I think the fun part about being a college student is there's going to be a lot of free food all over campus, and so definitely take advantage of that. It's you get to learn new programs, but you get free food at the same time, so that's always fun.
Okay, so when is the last day to opt out of health insurance? It's September 8th, which is also census day, and also the last day to meet with immigrant services to be added to the insurance waiver list. Ooh, will there be the Dream.us swag?
That's a question mark. Show up and maybe.
I love that. Yes. Okay, so let's see. I'm seeing Guadalupe and Gabriel. Jose, are you here? Oh, I see that Jose is just joining us. Let's just wait one more minute so that we can get ready with the questions. But I'm really excited for us to be here today. I just want to say really quickly, thank you, Guadalupe, Jose, and Gabriel for being here. This will allow all of the students an idea of the different experiences of our scholars, because as Yareli mentioned, we may have similar backgrounds, but at the same time, we are so unique and our experiences may be completely different. So really excited to be here. Thank you all, and thank you all for listening. At this time, for respect to our panelists, if you can, please turn on your cameras so that we can engage a little bit more face-to-face, even if we're virtual and it's a completely different setting. But Guadalupe, do you wanna get us started with introductions?
Yeah, hello everybody, and congratulations, whether you are graduating, transferring, and also receiving the scholarship. I just wanna say congratulations. I am very proud of all of you. My name is Guadalupe, of course, Lupita for short. I am an accounting major. Oh, pronouns, she, her, ella, la. And a fun fact about myself is that I am hard of hearing. I have no hearing at all in my left ear. So I have what I call the hovering thing. I just hover around people. So if I were meeting with you, you guys would probably see me hovering around. But yeah, those are some fun facts about me.
Thank you, Guadalupe. I didn't know that. And I've been meeting with you for years now. Perfect. Gabriel, do you want to go next?
Yeah. All right. So hi, everybody. My name is Gabriel Trujillo. My pronouns are he, him, his. And my major, I'm a social work major. And I'm expected to graduate in like 3 years, so like in 2024. And a fun fact about me, so one of them is I can just look at my shoulder on command. And the second fun fact about me is that my brother, he's my older brother, and he's also an incoming Dream.us scholar. So I'm really excited to be here with you all and to be able to share my journey alongside you all and alongside my brother.
Perfect. Thank you, Gabriel. Okay, we welcome now Jose.
What's up, everyone? Congrats on your new journey. And yeah, my name's Jose. I'm in English secondary ed major. I graduate in December. And one fun fact about me, I don't really have one that comes to mind. I didn't get to walk on my high school graduation because I started a food fight like my last week of high school. I guess that's something fun about me.
That's exciting. I mean,
it's not necessarily good, but it's fun.
It's a good fun fact that you can use in the future, right? It wasn't so fun back then, but you know, you're about to graduate in fall, so hopefully you're able to walk for your graduation. Well, thank you all. As you all can see, we have students from different majors, from different graduation dates. Jose is about to graduate, Guadalupe is graduating this summer, and Gabriel is a sophomore, an incoming sophomore. And so again, thank you, Jose, Guadalupe, Gabriel, for being here today. We're all in college, and you know, you all are the Dream.us scholars, and we want to know a little bit more. What makes getting a degree important to you? And Jose, if you want to go first.
Yeah, so there's a distinction, right, between getting a degree and being educated. I think you don't necessarily have to go to college or go to school to be educated, but the importance about getting a degree is, or at least the way I look at it, it's like having the password to an event that you're trying to get into. So if you're knocking on the door, they ask you for a password, you show them your degree, it gives you some type of credential. And like I said, you don't necessarily have to go to school to be educated, but having that degree does give you that pedigree where you can go into certain places where you perhaps wouldn't have gotten into it if you didn't have that piece of paper. And I think it also just gives you that extra confidence to knock at certain doors where you probably wouldn't be knocking if you didn't have that piece of paper.
Wow, that's a very important perspective. And I really appreciate you sharing what makes it important getting that degree right. And let's see, Gabriel, Guadalupe, do you want to add?
Yeah, this was something a wise woman told me, similar to what Jose was saying. She was an attorney, by the way. She was very scary, but she was very smart. She was like, Guadalupe, if you're gonna be educated, you might as well have something to show for. She's like, you drive with a license, don't you? And I was like, yeah. And she was like, well, and you can do the same with your degree, because there was a point where I was like, I don't know if school's exactly for me, but she set me straight. She was like, if you're gonna be an accountant, get your degree, and because at least you have something to show forth. You wouldn't be driving around without a license with you. And I was like, yep, you're right, you're right.
Well, you know, one of the most important things that I've learned being a scholar myself and also a student at a university is that having mentors is really important for that type of advice and that type of communication. So I'm glad that you were able to experience that with that lawyer, even though she was scarier, they were scary.
Wonderful woman. She was amazing. But yeah, look for somebody to look up to. And yeah, I'll move on to the next thing before I break out into another story.
Gabriel.
Yeah, so for me, like, getting a degree is important to me because it shows that all my hard work that I've done, you know, since I was in elementary school, since I was younger and stuff, has paid off, but not only my hard work, but also my family's hard work, and especially, like, my mom's hard work of her trying to, like, raise four kids alone and stuff, and just seeing, you know, like, all that hard work that my family has been putting in, you know, throughout our entire lives and stuff, and being able to go against, you know, to go against, like, the data and the statistics and stuff, and to go against all, like, the prejudice and racism and all of that hatred that's, like, against us, like dreamers and undocumented individuals and stuff. And I think that's something that just shows just, like, the full, like, power that we have and stuff, and the full potential that we have to create our own paths and to create our own lives as we see it fit for ourselves. And to just continue that hard work that comes from our family, to just continue it on and continue forward with it.
Yes, I completely agree with you, Gabriel. I feel like for me, it was always trying to, saying that my graduation wasn't only going to be a personal achievement, but also a family achievement. And a lot of you may relate to that, right? As first generation students, it's an honor to be able to graduate and be the first one in our families to do so. But again, now looking back at you, Guadalupe, that you were about to graduate, not just with your undergrad, but with your graduate degree. And Jose, you have one semester left. Gabriel, you were just done with your first year. What is something that you wish you, let me go back. What is something you know now that you wish you knew when you first started at MSU Denver?
Yeah, okay, cool. So something that I wish I knew before I started at MSU Denver, one is just, like, the importance of, like, connecting with other people and, like, the importance of, like, of creating, you know, like, connections with other people and socializing. Because, like, you know, before in high school, I was very quiet, very shy. I didn't talk with a lot of people. I never, like, connected with others and stuff. But now, like, this first year, I realized just how important it is to connect with people, you know, like, reaching out to people who you might not have, like, reached out before and stuff. And also not just connecting, like, with like other students and other scholars and stuff, but also with, like, professors, because, like, you know, they also have lives and they can be, like, very interesting just hearing, like, their life story and hearing how they have gotten to where they are. And so I think something really important is just, like, getting to know people and not being, like, afraid to just, like, talk with people and just talk about whatever interests both of you. And I think that's something that's really important, just, you know, just that socializing with others and just that connecting and just being able to have a lot of people that you can go to and for support and for just like friendship and just for and just to be happy and just to be like fulfilled.
Very important points, Gabriel. And again, if you know, being engaged on campus and asking those questions is truly important. So come tomorrow just to learn about organizations and programs. Guadalupe.
Yeah. Just to piggyback off of that, something that really struck with me and stayed with me my last 2 years in being in school is community. Then you can, because of course I'm part of the immigrant community, and also in my senior year, this last year, I was the president of the accounting student organization, which helped me a lot in different ways. And I just think that the sense of community in this university is very nice, because it's small to the point that you know who you're with, who you're talking to. You'll find yourself having a lot of similarities with your peers. And like for me in the ASO, when I had started in there, I had no idea what I was doing. I had never been into an organization. I was like, what is this for? But I went in one night, and two nights later, I ended up with two internships. So it helped me professionally. And then with the immigrant community, I really enjoyed going to getting coffee at DOSBUG and just meeting others who are also part of the Dream.us. That was really neat. I miss that. I feel like the sense of community in this university is really strong. It's very beautiful. And if you can join and be a part of as many communities as you can, please do so. Because like one professor that I had, for anybody going into accounting, if you have a professor, Mata, he would probably be like, you're only as strong as your network. And I'm like, okay, so I got a network and be a part of a community.
Yes, I love that, Guadalupe. And I also meet those meetings and events where we could be in person. It's great that you bring up the coffee at DASPOC, because Nayeli, peer mentor with Immigrant Services, just this morning had her first coffee meeting with a student. And so I was telling her how I remember when I was a peer mentor, we had coffee for the first time. And I think this was 2 years ago. So definitely we're starting to do that again slowly, but hopefully we can continue doing that in the future. So if you're wanting to get coffee with Nayeli, send an email to Nayeli and you can do that again. But yeah, Jose, what is something you wish you knew when you first started at MSU Denver?
Yeah, I think I would say two things. I think the first one has to do more with school, and the second one probably has to do more with life in general. So the first one is, I wish I would have known it back then that it's not necessarily wise to fall in love with everything your professors say. Like, just because they're smart and they're intelligent and they have all this vast information that you don't know, it doesn't always mean that you're going to share the same values as them. So it's one thing to separate intellect from values. I think it's important to keep the values you currently have, or to get them from somewhere else, not necessarily get them from the classroom at MSU Denver, because it's just a completely different environment. And I think it's just important to learn how to separate the two. But I think the one I would probably say in regards to life in general is be aware of the relationships that you have, especially the any romantic relationship you may have while you're a student. Because even though it may seem cool to have a girlfriend or boyfriend at the time and be going to school, and even though you can, you could probably handle it, just be aware that, yeah, you're gonna have to sacrifice a lot of time from your partner, and have to focus more of that time and energy in school. And especially if they're not capable of understanding that, then you're either gonna have problems in your relationship or in school. And I've seen a lot of people choose a relationship over school, and it's, yeah, it's only 4 years. You can just be smart about it. Be wise on who you choose as a boyfriend, girlfriend, and yeah.
Thank you for sharing that, Jose. I agree to a lot of that you said. For me, I remember working different jobs and then having to study that, which took a long time because I wanted to make sure I passed my classes and get good grades. But also I had to do homework and go to the actual class. So I was very busy, and a lot of that meant that I wasn't going to family meetings. And so that was very frustrating for me and for my family. And I remember at one point when they were very stressed at the fact that I wasn't going to family parties or I wasn't going on different things, right? I had to tell them, I'll have more time when I graduate to spend time with you. But for now, this is my focus. And it's what I chose to focus on. So thank you for bringing that up. Now, we have incoming students here. Some of them are transferring from a community college. Some of them are coming into the university as high school graduates. And so a lot of students may be already asking themselves this question, and it will be maybe helpful hearing from you. But how did you decide your major? How did you choose, or how did you explore all the different majors that are available in the university? And if you haven't decided on a major, what advice would you give?
I'll start this one off. So originally I was an engineering major when I was in the Community College of Denver. So if any alumni are there, woohoo, CCD. I hated it. I realized I hated it. And as what Jose was saying, you don't, just because your professors are smart, like, don't play to that. I was like, I really hate this. It got to the point that one semester I withdrew from like my two biggest classes, and I was like, I can't take it anymore. I am done. I really hate this. And so I went to one of my counselors because I was like, hey, look, I had to withdraw from two of my classes because I cannot deal with it. I really hate it. It's okay to not like your first choice. It's natural. Sometimes you have one idea, you find out a different thing. But I stuck enough for like two semesters that I realized I did not like what I was doing. And he was like, well, that's fine. It's okay. We'll switch you to undecided. And he was like, well, what do you like? So he was just bouncing off ideas with me. And he was like, you like numbers. You could be a math teacher. You can do this. Like, he was just giving me ideas, and I was like, yeah. And like, I was really reflecting on it. And then he was like, well, try out some intro classes. He's like, you have some scholarships and you need to be full time. So try taking a few classes. So I did that. I also took Spanish. Maybe I wanted, because I wasn't sure. I didn't know what I was doing. So for an entire year, I was like, I don't know what I'm doing. And that's totally fine. You don't have to feel bad about yourself that you are in one, and that you're in a place that you don't know what you're going to be doing. That's totally fine. I feel like all of us have been there at some point. And going back to reflecting with this mentor, he was like, well, yeah, just try a few classes, a few intro classes. That's fine. Join some organizations. So I took an intro to accounting class and I got it. And I was like, okay, I'm pretty good at this. And then I took the next class, and then I took a volunteer class where we were preparing tax returns for low-income families, and I really liked that, and I got the sense of what I was doing, and I appreciated that. And then I changed my major. Luckily, I was it just took me one time to switch around to figure out what I liked. And it's okay to be undecided. Just really focus on what you're doing and know what you want to do later on. And if you want to if you want to be something important, that's fine. If you don't, that's okay. Just know what you're doing and what you want to do with your life later on.
Amazing. That's an amazing story, Guadalupe. Basically, a lot of experiences that students have. I started as a nursing major. I thought I was going to be a registered nurse and helping, you know, people, which I absolutely love. However, I did take an anatomy and physiology, and we had a cadaver. I can't remember the name, but we were actually like in front of a cadaver, and I'm like, I don't think I can do this. And that was okay. Something that you mentioned is meeting with a mentor to explore different majors. So that's very important, because at MSU Denver, if you're still exploring and you don't know what you want to major in, that's completely okay. Like Guadalupe mentioned, it's good to explore. And at MSU Denver, we do have exploratory academic advisors that you can meet with. And they can also help you through that process. Like Guadalupe, like myself, we're supported with. Jose, what about you?
So for me, initially, I wanted to coach soccer. I wanted to coach at a college one day, and I thought that was gonna be what I did. But I just I realized that it was probably just better for my overall sanity if I just chose something else. So it's why I got into teaching, and I just love stories, books, writing. So it was kind of easy for me to choose being an English teacher. But I think if I had to give advice, I think the best advice I could give would just be to be honest with yourself and to ask yourself, what is it, like what type of life do you want to have? If money is really important to you, then yeah, you probably want to go that route. And it's fine if you want to go through that struggle and find something that pays very well, even if you don't really enjoy it, like it's your life. If you want to go another route, pick something that you really like doing, but perhaps doesn't pay that well, and you know you're going to be okay with it, then that's the route you should probably go. But just, yeah, don't pick something that just for the benefit of others, just because other people think that it'll be a good fit for you, or just to make someone else happy. I probably would say that's not the best way to go. Just be honest with yourself, ask yourself, what type of life do I want to have? And yeah, just go for it and put in the work. Any career you choose is going to be hard, so just pick one that's worth doing.
Yes, I love the advice that you're giving us. And yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, it has to be something that you really enjoy and that you wake up in the morning, you're excited to do, and you get energy from it, right? So thank you for sharing that. Now, Gabriel, this is the start to your second year at MSU Denver, compared to Jose and Guadalupe, who are a semester or right about, like, about to graduate, right? So what about you?
Yeah, okay, cool. So for me, I would say, so like, I'm a social work major, like as of right now and stuff, but I have like done thinking over the summer, and I'm thinking of like switching to like psychology and stuff. So once again, I have no idea yet, like what I want to major in exactly, but I think that's where I'm at right now, and where I have been like for the past year. You know, like I came in at MSU Denver wanting to be a math teacher. I was like, I'm gonna be a math teacher for the rest of my life. I'm gonna teach high school algebra, and that's gonna make me happy for the rest of my life. And then from there, I moved to like nursing. And then from nursing, I went to like biology. And then from biology, I moved to social work. And now from social work, I'm thinking of like psychology. So like I'm like this year for me as a major, like choosing my major has been very, very like complicated and stuff because I do not know what I want to major in because there's like because a lot of things interest me. And so I think something that I like would recommend stuff is like if a lot of things interest you, like during your once you're doing your general study classes and stuff, take like random classes if you want, just like random classes that might catch your eye and stuff to try and maybe draw something from there. And something I would also say, you know, it's going to the C2 hub and the career counseling and stuff because I got some career counseling and that was very helpful to really help me look at what is it that I really want and what is it that I like really want to do and what makes me happy and how, where do I see myself at and stuff. And I also did like informational interviews and just asking people, you know, like people who are in different fields and stuff, asking them how their day-to-day is, asking them, you know, like what do they see somebody in that position look for and stuff, you know, just seeing like how their days compare to what I want and to what I want my days to be like in the future. And something I just want to say, you know, it's like you don't need to know your major right away. That's something that's like that I feel like a lot of people are told, you know, that you need to know right away, but you don't. You can change it. You can change it as many times as you want. Stuff. You can change it as your interests change, as you start to get more interest and you start to interact with others and stuff. And something I also want to say, you know, it's just choose a major that's for you and stuff. And don't do it for anybody else. Like do something that will make you happy and something that will bring you joy and stuff. Because this is like your experience, not somebody else's experience. It's yours. And so now you have that chance to decide what you want and decide, you know, what you want and how you see yourself and what you could see yourself doing in the future. And so something I would just say, like, definitely, if you need help, like looking like for interest or something, or just looking around, just go to that career, to the career center and stuff and get some career counseling. And I'm also saying, you know, to talk with exploratory advisors, to talk with different professors at the school, talk with different advisors at the school. Just go out and just like talk with people and stuff and to make sure that what you choose is what you want and stuff. And like, if you don't find something or if you want to make some things together, there's always that like independent major where you can, you know, choose, like create your own major and design it to what you want it to be and stuff. And so, you know, there's a lot of options that you have. And so it just takes time. So give yourself that time. Don't get stressed out about it. Don't like think that you have it figured out already. Just take that time to really like look at what you want and just make it like, just make sure that it focuses on you. And I think that's like what I could give you. Just like make sure that it's something that you want and that you're not doing it for like your family or you're not doing it for anybody else, but mostly just for you. And yeah.
Absolutely. Thank you, Gabriel. And yes, I agree with you. It's completely okay to still be exploring. Like I said, I went to CCDM for 2 whole years. I thought I wanted to be a nurse, so I was taking the prerequisites. I had an associate's in science with the prerequisites of nursing. So completely okay to still be exploring. And yes, it's important that we take those classes to see if we like them or not. But now I want to get the conversation changed, the topic changed a little bit. What are some studying or time management tips that you would give the incoming students?
I'll go first on this one. So I have a two-piece. So know and play to your strengths. So if it's studying, for instance, if you know you cannot study with flashcards, do not study with flashcards. If you are a repetitive learner that you need to do multiple problems to get it, do that. If you know you're not doing something right and you're not getting it, that's okay. Know how to reach out to tutors because there are various tutors and tutoring labs in MSU. And I think the office is pretty close to one. So definitely know your strengths and weaknesses when studying. Also, when you scheduled your classes, because you're going to have a whole newfound freedom with scheduling your classes. I know for myself, I was not good at taking morning classes. Most of my classes were in the afternoon and evening. So that was just personally me. I played to my strengths. So that, and that helps me a lot. And then the second piece of advice that I want to give is know your due dates academically and in campus. If the scholarship requires you to turn in your passport in time, do that, and do that as early as you can so you're over it. If you're gonna have a meet the ferns, which is an accounting thing, know when that date is. If there's going to be an event happening that you need attention, really know your due dates and your dates, basically. That is all I have.
I think something I would add to that is prioritize your sleep. If you know that you can't function without your 8 hours, then that's what you should do. I think it's easy to assume that just because you're in college and you're busy all the time, that you should sacrifice some of your sleep, but it's just one of those things where you just have to think about it. Like if you know you're a lot more efficient on 8 hours of sleep, then it makes more sense to get that amount of sleep and get something done in 20 minutes as opposed to only getting 6 hours of sleep and spending 2.5 hours on something that should have taken you only 20 minutes in the first place. So think about efficiency, not just how much time you allocate to like a certain project or something. Because even if you have 4 hours available of studying, maybe it's not useful to use all those 4 hours. Maybe it's better to only go to the library for 2 hours and actually study and actually work, and then use the other 2 hours to go and watch a movie instead of being in the library for 4 hours. And yeah, like you do some work for 15 minutes and then you're on Facebook. So it's one of those things where you just really have to pinpoint your time and realize what you have to get done, but also realizing that you should probably focus some time on yourself, on having fun, and actually scheduling that out. Like it could really help you out. But sleep, that's my advice.
Oh goodness, Jose. You're bringing me back to when I was a student, and now I'm realizing that probably if I would have gone to sleep earlier instead of staying up all night and then going to class would have helped me so much better concentrate and to also do good on those exams, because sometimes I would just study throughout the night and then not end up, you know, doing like as good as I should have if I had fallen asleep earlier. Thank you for bringing that up.
Yeah, so for me, I would say like something to like, well, for time management and studying, I think something, you know, it just either if you have a planner or just like a plain piece of paper and stuff, just like write down your to-dos that you have, you know, just whatever you have to do for like classes and stuff, whatever deadlines you have, and whatever you have to do for like that day. So you know what you have to get done, and then you can, and then once you're looking at it, you can know, you know, like what you have to get done for that day and what time you might be able to organize and stuff to get it done and stuff. So I just think that something is writing down what you need to do and when you think you're gonna do it and stuff to make sure that you are on top of all your homeworks and you're on top of all your deadlines and that you are like studying for your exams and stuff. So just making sure, you know, that like you are aware of what like things you need to get done for your courses and stuff. And something else I would definitely suggest and stuff with studying and time management would be like, if I feel like a lot of things it has to do with like mental health and stuff. So if you feel, you know, like that they're not able to like manage your time because of things, or if you have like other things on your mind and stuff, I mean, you feel like you need counseling, go to a counseling center. You know, like students have free counseling. And so use that counseling center, and that will help you make yourself better in your mental health, which will help you study better and be able to manage your time better. And so I think, you know, just going to a counseling center and always writing down what you have to do.
You bring up an excellent point, Gabriel. I will share the counseling center link so that you can call, schedule an appointment. There's a lot of stigma around mental health, and it is important that you take care of yourselves. So I will definitely share that with you. But those are the questions we had for the panel. I know that all of you may also have questions for our panelists. So please feel free and really quickly, I wanted to mention to also attend the Dreamer Processing Spaces. Thank you, Nayeli, for letting me know, which are spaces for DACA and undocumented students where we talk about different topics. And also we talk about coping mechanisms and the ways that we do. We also have breathing techniques and just mental health resources. We'll share the flyers with you. You'll get them on your MSU Denver email once we have those dates again. And I think Gregor shared that. Yeah, Gregor shared it. Thank you, Gregor. So I want to open it up to all of you now. You are the ones coming into MSU Denver as a DREAM.US scholar. So please feel free to unmute and ask your questions, or if you would prefer, you can write those questions on the chat. What questions do you all have? And it's okay if you don't have any right now. I know some will pop up. So how many credits did you take? And I guess we can say per semester.
I took 12 per semester. That was my absolute limit. I took 15 once, deeply regret it. And in the summers, I only limited myself to 3 credit hours. Yeah, 12 credit hours. Yeah. So 4 classes. The summer, only 1 class, 3 credit hours. Be easy on yourself with those credit hours, okay? One will make a difference a lot.
Do you want to go first, Jose?
No, go ahead.
Okay, cool. Yeah, so for me, I think that for me, a lot of it has been influenced by being online and stuff. But I decided my first semester to take 5 classes. And then my second semester, I took 6 classes. And let me tell you, that experience really made me realize how much I value my time and how much I really do need to focus, prioritize school, but also prioritize myself and stuff. And so from those two semesters, I've learned that I don't need to take a lot of classes and stuff in order to be productive, that I can take less classes and still be productive and still do the things that I want to do. And so for the next semester, I'm trying to take only 4 classes, which is 12 credits. And also I just gotta say, there are some classes that are just one credit hour and stuff, some labs and stuff for biology and chemistry and stuff. But don't be fooled, just because it says 1 credit hour, there's still a lot that goes on between those classes. And so that 1 credit class will still take an amount, will still take a big chunk of your time, and either through the actual meeting or through homework. There's a lot that you just really look into whenever choosing classes, how many credits you want to take. And if you function, with 5 to 6 classes, good for you. If you function with 2 or 3, good for you. Either way, it's what you want and it's how you want to make it. And so you have that option to really make it all about you basically, and make sure that you are doing what's best for you and personalizing it for you.
Yeah, so for me, I always took 15 or more credits, always five or more classes. That's just, in a weird way, that's just how I like to function. And yeah, I always found that I do better when I'm constantly busy, which also brings me to Christian's question on what was the key for you guys to have a good work and school balance. So yeah, besides the 15 credit classes that I would take, I would also work full time. And I think just one key about work and school is, well, kind of what I said earlier, is just make sure you get your sleep, make sure that every like second of your day gets accounted for, and that includes free time. Just kind of schedule that ahead of time. And one tip that worked for me was that I would always schedule my PTO, my vacation time for work, during finals week or during the week before finals week. And just making those adjustments, looking at your schedule for the semester ahead of time and just picking out the days that you think are going to be the toughest.
Excellent. Thank you, Jose, for letting us know the key for you to have that good work and school balance. I know that, Mariana, you asked what 12 credits were, and everyone kind of answered that already. So for each credit, let's say 12 credits, it's probably three classes on average. But it just means how many hours per week you are going to the lecture. So if it's a 3-hour class, then you're spending 3 hours per week. So if you're doing Monday, Wednesdays, it would be 1 and 15 minutes each day. But yeah, what about Guadalupe and Gabriel? What is a good key, for a good work and school balance?
Knowing what classes you're going to have ahead of time and knowing what you're going to do. So when I was transferring from CCD to MSU, and I'm very, very grateful and thankful for the amount of support that I have had, because thanks to that and also to my parents, I did not have to work full time. I was only able to work part time. So yay. Because I was transferring and I didn't know, like, I was like, okay, I'm taking these classes, I don't know the professors, I was able to take a full year off for me to properly transition from one school to another. But my key was just really knowing those classes and getting feedback from my peers to see what those classes were going to be like. I was just like, hey, like, have you taken auditing? Like, what's that class like? Have you taken this? What's that like? And I prioritized my classes depending on how much work I was going to be doing. But work was the second thing of my worries. Just because I didn't have to work, I wanted to work. Also knowing that distinction, however it looks like to you, just knowing if you have to work or you want to work. Because I just feel like a lot of people think they have to work when they have a good amount of support and they don't have to, so they can prioritize a little better their school and educational needs.
Perfect, thank you. And I'm seeing a lot of questions, which all of them are great. Thank you all for asking them. We really appreciate them. If we don't get to all your questions, we will send some of the answers by email. But there is another question here that Gregor already answered. So what can I do if my tuition says out of state? You can complete the in-state correction form. If you already completed that form and you still show us out of state, you may be missing your COF application, or it's just that they are still processing. Please meet with us and we can verify that. Usually the in-state correction form has 5 to 7 week processing time. So please make an appointment with us. Now, another question here is, if you're in the insurance waiver list, by when will the insurance fee be taken out of your tuition? Great question. So The latest will be September 8th on census day. So please make sure you're scheduling an appointment with us. If you already scheduled an appointment and you were added to the insurance waiver list, then just please be patient and wait until September 8th for that fee to be removed. Now, Jackie's asking, it makes sense now because in the beginning I was like 3-4 classes doesn't sound like a lot, but hearing, oh, it's more of a comment, but hearing about it right now, I guess one class makes a difference. Yes, with everything that our panelists said, it does make a difference. I also took 15 credits once and I was like, why? Awesome, let's see. If you are on the waiver list, you do not need to have any insurance, correct? Even if you are a full-time student. That's correct, but please reach out to us and we can help you find different accessible healthcare services if you were added to the insurance list. And if you haven't, please schedule an appointment with us. And then I see Jasmine share the correction form. Perfect. Well, I think those were all the questions. Since the in-state correction form came out, if you want to share your experience of submitting your in-state correction form and how that was for you. Or any tips that you would give?
Well, it was, for me, it was a long time ago, but frankly, it was quite easy. I just went to school one random day and that's another thing. If you just so happen to be in campus in the building, it's okay to drop by. I think I annoyed a lot of people just dropping by randomly and going, hey, how's it going? But sometimes during those drop bys, I would get a lot of things done. So in one of those drop-offs that I just went, I was like, hey, so my tuition is like this. They gave me my form. It was a paper form. I filled it out and then I just went downstairs one floor and to the financial aid office, I think, turned it in there. And then a week later, they adjusted my tuition to in-state. So it was frankly quite easy. Trust me, a lot of these processes are a lot easier than what they seem. Don't be scared of them. Filling out the DIA, getting everything. It's quite easy. Just do reserve a little bit of time just to get those things done, and also stay in touch with your mentors to make sure that you don't have anything outstanding. But yeah, it was quite easy. I did mine so long ago, I don't remember. All I remember is I got a sheet, filled it out, turned it in. 1 week later, I was good.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. And for me, so mine involved a lot less walking. For me, it was all, since this entire year has been all virtual and stuff, like I emailed Stephanie and stuff for it and stuff, and she sent it over to me, and yeah, so I just like filled it out, I took a picture of it, and I just sent it back, you know, a lot less walking, a lot less moving floors. So yeah, you know, and I definitely agree with what Lupe said about, you know, a lot of these processes, like seeing, you know, like due to the name or something, that's something like major or something huge or like something that they fill out like a lot of paperwork for and stuff. But a lot of these things are just like really easy to do and stuff. And also like, and don't take that much time. It's just, you know, just communicating with, you know, with whoever you need to communicate with and stuff in order to get like what paperwork you need and in order to just like find that help that you need.
Awesome, thank you both, which brings a great point. I know that there's a question, how do you know if you were added to the insurance list? Make an appointment with us. You won't know if you don't remember if you met with us and we had that conversation, you won't know because that fee will still be added into your tuition, which is $1,082 for fall 2021. But meet with us and we can tell you if you were added. Please know your 900 number because we needed to verify. The last day to drop classes is August 29th, a week after classes start, with a 100% to refund, or meaning that the Dream.us will not pay any of the scholarship. And then in order to receive a 50% refund, or meaning that the DreamWS scholarship will pay for 50%, is August 8th, which is also September 8th, which is also Census Day. Okay, and I see that Gregor had answered that. Well, anyways, I want to go ahead quickly. I know we only have 3 minutes, but I want to go ahead and thank our panelists for being here and being willing to share your stories while Lupe is about to graduate. So she's taking summer classes, and that's very rigorous and very accelerated right before graduation. So thank you so much for making some time out of your busy schedule, all of you, because I know that you're working and just being here and sharing your time. I do want to go ahead and go around with one word of how we are all feeling. So if you can please unmute or share in the chat. And I am going to start. I am feeling grateful, and I'll pass it over to Gregor.
Thanks, Fanny. I've been working with Dream.us students since like 2016, and every time I get to see you all and I get to see the new group of Dream.us scholars come in, I'm just overwhelmed by just how incredibly like hardworking you all are to have earned this very selective scholarship. And so I guess my word is impressed.
I'm thankful.
I'm excited to, it's exciting, I'm excited to meet everybody, like, you know, hopefully in person this coming fall, and just be able to connect with all of you.
I'm reminiscent. I remember when I was in your shoes not too long ago, and it's good. It's good to remember and also realize that you're gonna finish soon before you know it.
I'm so excited for all of you. Y'all are gonna do awesome.
This is my second year working with the Dream.us program, and I am super excited. You guys bring a lot of energy and positive energy, and you guys are very powerful. And so I'm really excited to be working with you guys.
And I'll go down my screen so Nayeli.
I feel very excited too. I'm excited to meet some of you tomorrow, and I guess work with you guys in the upcoming year.
April?
Well, I put it in the chat, but I just want to say that I'm very excited about meeting all of you, and I look forward to meeting with you through the semester and through the year. I'm talking with you about career possibilities. Thanks.
Christian.
I am comforted knowing that we all share one important aspect of our life, and knowing that we have this strong support group for each other, that just makes me feel really comforted.
Carmen.
I'm feeling very much prepared now and more confident, and I'm also thankful to now know so many great people that share the same experiences and who I can learn from too.
Okay, Juan Cortez.
I guess one word I can choose is I'm blessed, because a couple months ago, I wasn't even thinking about going to college. And now here I am, all of us going to college now. And I don't know, all I can say is I'm extremely blessed to be here and have this amazing opportunity in front of me.
Awesome, get at me.
I feel confident about this new year coming, and I feel proud of us for everything that we've done together.
Awesome. Irving.
I would say proud because we all worked very hard for this, you know? So.
Perfect. Citlali.
I would say I'm excited just to see what the future holds. And I feel also just really proud of every single person. And I didn't realize that I would share this much personal information with other people. So I'm very proud of us and just how far we've come.
Amazing. Anais.
I'm feeling very grateful because of this opportunity that I get to have and like for the rest of us. And like, I'm really grateful for everyone that shared today because it just reminds me that I can go to college even if you're undocumented or like you're a dreamer or anything like that. So I'm really happy for this.
Yes, absolutely. Araceli.
First of all, I want to say thank you to all of you for being here. I definitely feel more comfortable, you know, because I did feel scared, honestly, because I have been away from school for such a long time. I definitely feel blessed to have this amazing opportunity and to show myself and my family how far I can get. I feel emotional, honestly. It makes me cry almost because, you know, we all came here and it was hard. And here we are working hard to accomplish our dreams. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing, Araceli. I know we're all emotional now.
Thank you.
Mariana Ortega.
I feel kind of nauseous, like, you know, when you eat a lot of sugar because you love sugar and it's like college is like fun, but it's also nervous. So then you get like nauseous because you ate a lot of sugar.
That's amazing. Valerie.
I would also say excited just to go to college and then very proud of getting the scholarship.
Awesome. René Domínguez. Oh, and I see you shared in the chat. Ovi Mendez.
I'm feeling really excited. I learned a lot of things, a lot of tips. Shout out to the people that came out here and spoke a little. But yeah, I'm definitely excited.
Awesome. Abraham.
I'd say thankful for the community and the opportunity to go to college, even after all the hard stuff everyone has gone through. Yeah, just so thankful.
Awesome. Diana.
I'm excited to start this like new chapter of my life, and it makes me feel proud of myself as well as you guys. And I hope that our journey is filled with like success and blessings.
Awesome.